of the holding company, but this is going to change. It was called DataStreamX, and the original idea has started from April 2014. After a year, on January 2015, we graduated from JFDI Accelerator and closed our first angel funding. We do have a representative from JFDI. Later, on July 2015, the first data marketplace one-click stop was ready, and we have started with our first transactions. For those who don't know what DataStreamX was, it was the first online data marketplace. That means from the easiness of your computer at home, you could buy data sets from all over the world. During June 2016, we got VC-backed by Wavemaker Labs of Draper Venture Network. Our CEO, Mike Daly, right now is in New York, and after he's traveling to Silicon Valley to meet Draper Network. He's presenting there, that's why he couldn't be with us today. Later, on June 2017, we did our first landmark when it comes to data transacting. We have incredible experience in this sector. We managed to have 5 billion data records transacted monthly. Later, we can see over 20 billion on the latest available update on March 2018. The numbers continue until to date. Were approximately 20 billion data. Among to the companies, they are buying data sets from us are banks, VC, big supply chain companies like McDonald's, Burger King, and everybody who has need for big data sets. During June, I'm stating June because it started the last day of June, but actually it's July 2018. We hosted our initial coin offering and we managed to raise $15.5 million. Of course, Ethereum was higher than now. It was around $550. Now Ethereum is at a low of 200. As you can see, we are a team committed with long-term development of the data economy. We didn't just notice the bacon for blockchain need because I will call to use the word bubble, but everybody is speaking about blockchain and everybody is building something on blockchain. We are here from 2014 and we are planning to stay for many more years. Our funding we got help us to continue operations at least for 7 years. So it is guaranteed that for the next 7 years we are going to operate, and hopefully with your support and our global partners for more. When it comes to data, I have separated and I have figured out that three are the most important categories, the challenges and risks we are going to identify the following years. The first one is geostrategic trends. I'm going to explain each category later. The second one is the adoption and regulation. I guess most of you will be aware of GDPR regulation that makes more difficult to transact data, especially if you don't know the original source or if you don't have the consensus from the data party. And the emerging data economy. I'm going to present some numbers. Which are really appealing about the future of the data industry. When it comes to geostrategic trends, we may emphasize on our development in South Asian market. We're based in Singapore. And you can see that China and the whole region are rising exponentially. Asia is home of 40% of human population, a poll for economic growth and innovation. Unfortunately, Europe is really slow comparing to Asian economies and still projected to be the fastest growing region through 2030. The adoption and regulation, especially in the Asian market, is really promising, and I just going to point that the survey from Chinese executives indicate that 50%, more than 50% actually, of businesses will start relying on machine learning. For machine learning operations, of course, they need accurate data sets. Some landmarks that define data economy as emerging. There's a significant growth in smartphone penetration. I doubt that anybody exists without a smartphone today. Even my mother, who was not familiar with smartphones, now she bought the iPhone. And I have seen this problem because it has started Facebook and is all the time connected. The reliance on data analytics from small businesses to big government. Now it's nothing random. Especially in Singapore, the government is paying real attention to gather the most important details from your personal data. They have many cooperations with telephone and telecommunications companies offering data sources. And specifically, we have an active partnership with Singaporean government right now to help them much better the transportation. So we monitor all the data sources from their mobiles, and we give them updates related to the frequency of buses, how many people they need those services, and help them optimize the transportation network. This is a really huge partnership with a lot of competition, and we managed to get it, and it's a great project to start. Later, I'm going to see how we are further involved with Singaporean government in the areas. Some other data, like Internet of Things devices, it's projected to be around 8.6 billion by 2020, and according to the latest available research, it was 3.1 back in 2015. The finance spending is going to exceed 16.7 USD million on Internet of Things. And now I'm going to identify a few categories and why the future of the big data sector is really, really promising. First, we're going to present some numbers, the bacon for blockchain, and why we needed to adapt on blockchain for our own solution, and the political mindset. I have included some country analysis because we are based in Singapore. It's time to release one really good update that we have recently. We have partnered with IMDA. IMDA, I'm not sure if you have a similar agency, probably, but as Igor told me, that is helping companies to travel their news across the globe. They have invested in DataStreamX, the holding company of Quadrant, and we can say that they are official partners. Recently, they have helped us organize a trip in China. We have gone there and we met with Chinese officials due to the support of the Singaporean government. Singaporean government as well is really supporting in Greece where I'm based. There is no chance if you send an email. Actually, you can't even send an email to the government. You need to go there and wait huge lines in Singapore. There's a dedicated project manager who can help you and can solve your problem really quickly. There is strong banking and finance sector that can support innovation. And also, this is a different mindset. First, they innovate and then they regulate, comparing to other economies. Later, we're going to have a small workshop about the regulation in the European Union of cryptocurrencies. In Singapore, everything is totally different. And of course, there's an established fintech and startup ecosystem. Here are only a small number of the successful. I'm pointing that those are only the successful fintech Singaporean startups. Just an image, probably you know Grab. And you can see how many initiatives have originated from the Singaporean government. IMDA is how wrong. And let's go to the data challenges. Let me tell you a story about how Quadrant started. We had one client, unfortunately I can't name them, but they're coming from the automotive industry. our job as a marketplace were not to examine. We had the feedback session, they could give feedback about the data sets, but we were not going to deeper to analyze the origin of those data. We're just trusting the providers. During the previous summer, one of our clients has bought 5 different data sets from Singapore, and he has identified, actually we did, our data scientist has identified that those data sets were really, really close to each other. So we thought that this is something really suspicious and we need to dig further why this has happened. We did an analysis and we understood that the data origin, like the company that was selling the data, had resellers. So those resellers actually were saying they're selling the same product. And just imagine the cost, and I will not even say the risks of buying the same data. First of all, it's time consuming, it's not productive. Third one, you can't rely on it because one app, you know that most of the apps that you have installed in your mobile phones are tracking your location, at least your location, and other behavior. Just imagine a company buying a feed only from, let's say, a favorite news site, but maybe this app, it was installed only in a specific audience, let's say elderly people who want information about the stock market, so they didn't have any younger audience. And that's why we thought that we really need to create a trusted solution to help and identify the data origin and the data authenticity. The fact here I told you that I'm going to speak about the challenges the data economy is facing, and the first one is data access. If you are going to ask most of the startups, buying or having access to data is pretty expensive, so we have to identify this one as the biggest difficulty, that there is lack for the data. The second one is data discovery. Most of the data sources are not cleaned, and actually nobody's going to clean them for you because they don't know your business needs. This is a common problem even data scientists are facing. There is a gap, there is a huge difference between the business needs and what data scientists are called to do as an action. The third one is data integrity. You don't know where you bought the source, or if this source is not a reseller. And also, you can't be about the source like the audience or the other metrics. Now, we're providing a solution for that. The fourth one is data mapping. For example, when it comes to McDonald's, the user, McDonald's is a very well-developed company, but let's say another supply chain one that is now are establishing chains across the world. I'm going to use an example from Greece. It's called Mikel. It's the biggest coffee chain. They are trying to compete Starbucks. They do great in Greece, and now they're expanding all over the world. As you can understand, even if they have some local partners, they need to verify that those information are accurate and it's worth to invest in those economies. They have 2 different solutions in order to check how the visibility of a place, if it's a good location. They can just hire somebody like me. He can stay outside of the road and he can write some points that like 20 persons have crossed during 9 to 10, 50 persons during 10 to 11. As you can see, this will never work, and the labor is really expensive. The second one, and most trusted and most convenient, is to get access to data analytics. So they can find a local provider. As you can understand, it's impossible to do a very well research for every economy they are expanding. So they really need to trust that person. What about if those data are manipulated, are expired, are really old, and they're selling them like recent everybody knows that, how easy it is to manipulate data. And also, it's there's a need to combine. As I told you, even if you find data that are accurate and you trust their source, they might be limited to a specific audience. So data mapping is the science that can connect different data sets and get results. This takes a lot of time and is very, very expensive. And the final one is data distribution. But let's not bother. Do you have any data scientists here? Probably not. Okay, so I'm not going to emphasize on this because we're going to the technical. And let's see how the future will look like about the blockchain enabling data economy and how Quadrant fits. I'm going to present pretty slow here so you can understand, and maybe it's time to have some nice translation. So we have the Atomic Data Producer. Atomic Data Producer is an application or somebody who is producing data, but not me as an object of data like Nikos. It's a company that created different data sources.
Ну, поставщик данных, понятно. Не, не, пока понятно. Understand.
The biggest issue of atomic data producer is that they are underpaid. That means companies are trying to squeeze their income to get more. But they want more from them, they are not willing to pay. I guess this is a challenge in every single industry. They are trying to squeeze the income of producers. So we have, as you can see, different producers who are combining those data. And we call those companies as resellers. So they get access from atomic data producers and they're trained to sell them as data sets. We have different, and we have data consumer. Data consumer is a company that needs access to those data. There are two main challenges for data consumers. They want to be sure about the quality of their data and their applications, because most of them, they are taking really important business decisions with them. And the second one, they want to minimize the cost they're spending to acquire those data. And we're going to the next slide that we're mainly speaking about the needs of those companies that are buying data. It's like provenance. They want to have a clear understanding how the data have been collected. And now when it comes to the GDPR era, which is not affect only European companies, but all over the world, if they deal with European consumers, they really need to know that they had the consensus to contact you. For example, you have given your email address, we had a form and that you have agreed with the terms. So, but we can't tell to somebody because it's a paper, so we can't prove that you have given the consensus to send you an email. And this is illegal. We know that this is authenticity. This is authentic in case we have blockchain. Now, because we have only few, but if we had, let's say, a secretary, in order to prove that she did better work and has approached many people, she could write like 10 different emails. There is also trust, because so blockchain is immutable ledger. Nobody can violate it, can add something more than what the technology is going to provide. It's secure. It needs a lot of resources in order to manipulate it, and usually it doesn't deserve the effort. And it's integrity since you have all the other. And we can see how the Galaxian inspired Quadrant ecosystem could look. We have mercenaries, pioneers, aliens, and data consumers. Here we name few of our ideal partners. When it comes to data producers, we mainly address two applications and those with data stream products like Netflix or regional websites, probably most of the TV stations and radio stations are monitoring your online behavior. The second one, this is like the most critical, the message finders and demons could be AI internal companies, those with high thirst for data. So this is data consumers. Those companies could be location applications, probably you know Uber or Grab, maybe it has another name. Those companies have been big because they have great access to data. Even Google Maps is tracking millions devices, billions actually all over the world, but here in Russia, millions to monitor the traffic jam, and you can see for the same trip, the duration usually varies because they can monitor your mobile data, how much time the previous from you has spent in order to travel from the X place to another. And the fourth one, when it comes to funding, I'm going to present the map later with many address. You see we have strong applications in the blockchain and data space. Let's understand who are those people who make Quadran, because it's a decentralized application. We don't intervene. We're able to consult if somebody needs technical guidance or anything from us, but we don't do the end. And after we transition the Guardian nodes. Guardian nodes are the people who provide the hash power for the network to power. It will be totally decentralized. The nurseries, those people who we name that they produce the stars, stamp the hash DNA into Quadrant. Later we'll see that the nurseries are becoming the Guardian nodes. We have pioneers, we map the disparate collection of stars and turn them into constellations. Constellation is another term for data sets. Those as pioneers is the most vital part of Quadrant's ecosystem, and usually are data engineers who take the data and make products with it. The elons are mainly entrepreneurs who can understand and create specific data sources. For example, they can take 10 different trusted data sets from pioneers and make one final product for the finance industry, for the food industry, or they can name it. Then they can sell those applications in our marketplace, which is going to be ready in about a year. For data consumers, we have understood and we presented analytically before. Here is the map, all those countries being with light blue color. We have the presentation there. And here we are in Russia. We have four different VC capitals. One of them is FinForge. And again, thank you for hosting us. As I said, Russia is a strategic market, a lot of young and promising human capital. Many fintech companies are based here and will be more active. We are also looking for people, local people who want to join us. Here are our contact details, and if somebody wants to have a meeting with me, we can have after a session after the meetup. Now we have prepared some short videos that are more technical because I'm coming from the business operations. I'm not a data scientist. The local team here made great effort and translated all those videos to Russian for you, and we're going to upload them to social media if you want to share them later. And after that, we're going to speak a little bit about cryptocurrencies and regulation. It's not going to be a presentation. I will make it more interactive, like a workshop. But let's see the video. So, thanks a lot.
Спасибо.